Today I would like to share with you my study of a very dear to me passage. Turn with me to Gospel of John chapter 13, and we will read verses 33 through 35. And while you're turning, I will just give you a little bit of the context where we are. You remember that chapter 13 starts with the description of the Last Supper. So Jesus and the disciples, they are gathering together in the upper room for the last meeting. And description of that meeting actually takes five chapters in the Gospel of John. So evidently, Holy Spirit considers it as a very important information for us to know. So, and the chapter 13, this is the first chapter in these five. It focuses specifically, first of all, on Jesus washing disciples' feet. You remember that expression of Jesus' love. Jesus expressed his love, and we actually read that he loved them to the end. So that was the deepest expression of his love. Then we will read that during this evening, the New Testament was proclaimed. The Lord's Supper was established at this moment. Then we read that between Jesus and Judas, we see the interaction and disciples are asking, who is that person who will betray you? And right before, Jesus is starting to bring his final word to the disciples, and he is teaching a lot to them here in these chapters. Right before that, Jesus is taking time to make a very special point. Let's read verses 33. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You will seek me, and just as I say to the Jews, so now I also say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. It's a very important passage, and in part because of its topic. This passage focuses on love. And love is the ultimate virtue that human can possess. If you look around, if you look deep into your heart, you will see that people are seeking love, they are expecting love, they are doing everything that they can to have that love, and to receive love, and even to produce it in themselves. They want that atmosphere, that's a very pleasant atmosphere. But unfortunately, despite a lot of novels written to that, a lot of music which people sing about love, despite all the searches, all attempts to get that love, we see that love evades us. We see that most of the people, they don't find love, or even when they do find love, it's short-lived, it's changed. They see, they are disappointed at one point or sooner or later, they are disappointed. There are several reasons for that. Reason number one is that we are affected by fall, greatly affected by the fall. When humans fell, when Adam and Eve, in them, all of us, they fell into sin, at that moment we have experienced something dramatic in our nature. The number one thing which changed our view of love, our understanding of love. So we have now wrong perspective. When we desire love, when we desire way to be loved, when we seek to be loved, when we even try to love, when we sing about love, we are looking actually for something different than real love, what real love is. That's number one thing. The second problem what we have, it's also a result of the fall, is that after the fall, we lost our capacity to love. We need to know that number one problem that affected all human beings after the fall is selfishness. The root of sin is that desire to be higher of others, to be more significant than others, and that desire to have my own desires, my own wishes, my own feelings to be satisfied, and that desire tops everything else. Even when we are trying to be sacrificial, even when we try to love to our utmost, we are doing our best. If you look deep down into your heart, you will find selfishness there. It's a part of our spiritual DNA after the fall. That's the problem. And now we're caught in that tension, constant tension. From one on the one side, we do want to have that real love which brings fulfillment. But at the same time, we have something inside of us. We have that deeply rooted selfishness which poisons love, which poisons real love. And because of that, we have that ongoing problem. Yet there is another side to this problem. When we're talking about Christians, Christians are not exempt from it. Of course, we as Christians, we understand that. We accept Christ and we learn from Him and we learn from His Word and we want to have that real love which Christ brings. But very, very often, we find that we ourselves, we are not capable of such love. So this makes study of this passage especially important. As I told you, this is one of the dearest passages for myself. That passage addresses several very important issues. I would like to start with the last one first and then mention a couple in verse 34 and then proceed to study that. Look at verse 35. Verse 35 explains us that in God's provision, in His view, He considered that the ability to have that love, that special God's love in our life, is the most important category, the most important quality by which He wants to spread the testimony of real God's salvation. And that's a very important thing. Very, very often we Christians, especially evangelical Christians, especially those Christians who are considering the high authority of the Holy Scripture, we downplay this. That's a point that we will address during this sermon, Lord willing. And there are a couple of others. The number one in verse 34, we see that Jesus commanding us to love. That's a very strange way of talking about love. He's commanding, He gives command to love. And then He mentions that it's a new command. So let's start with the command. Of course, when we're talking about love, we never think about love that can be forced. You cannot force someone to love others. In Russian, we have a very good saying, «Насильно мил не будешь». I don't know how to translate it into English. Somebody gave me some equivalent that you can lead horse to water, but you cannot make it drink it. Maybe it's something similar, but not exactly. But the point is that when we're talking about love, we're talking about something that should spring out of the heart voluntarily. It just should happen inside of you. But Jesus is saying about something very different. And you remember, He is God. He knows us very well. And He knows that Russian and American saying. Even Russians and Americans did not exist at that time. But He knew that. He knows our nature. But despite that, he is saying, he's commanding you, commanding me. He's commanding his disciples. He's saying, you have to love. You must love one another. That's very interesting. Let's read verse 34. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. You might have heard about the term agape love. Most likely, if you are a Christian for a while, you somewhere you have read it or heard about that. And this is the way how Greeks, and you know that New Testament was written in Greek, how they expressed their idea of love. There are several different words they use to express love. And here we have this very specific word. I will give you a definition, just one of the simplest definitions that I have in one of the lexicons. Agapao, which means to love, this is the verb. It's love, especially of love, is based on evaluation and choice, a matter of will and action towards the person. When we're talking about towards the person, it's love, be loyal to, regard highly. So it is the love of commitment. So it's a desire which comes out of decision. There is a decision made. In hearts, willing decisions. So it's an act of will, we see. It is the kind of love that is fully dependent on the giver and not on the recipient. Of course, we as Christians probably have heard about this kind of love and even recognize that it is good to have it. But if you look deep down into your heart, you will most likely find that you are not seeking that love. When you are talking about love, you desire something more emotionally consuming, something that just happens, something just which moves your emotions and feelings, and you just feel good. You just feel good because you loved or you are in love. So when we are talking about love, we expect something like that. We are not thinking about agape love. This is why we love those who are lovable. We love those that we are comfortable with. It's very difficult to love the awkward people, unimpressive, annoying people. But this is not the type of love Christ speaks about here. Jesus had a range of words at his disposal. He could have chosen the term phileo, which means that affectual love that two persons, quite often it's brotherly love or friends, when they have that mutual love, when they love in response, and that love filled with a lot of affection. He could have chosen the term storge, and that word used when expressed the love between relatives. When you have brother and sister or sister, even when you don't have the greatest relationships, but you are part of the family. You are getting together and you tolerate with each other. That's the part of the deal. But Christ did not speak of it. He did not use these terms, nor was he speaking about eros, that emotionally charged love of physical affection. He had chosen to speak about love with the word agape. This is love of commitment. Agape is the God's kind of love. Whenever you read about God loving, you will always find this word agape. Let's give you an example. John 3:35. The Father loves, and here we have hopater, agapa. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into His hands. Actually, when we're talking about the Holy Trinity, the glue that that glues all of them together, three persons of the Trinity, they have deep love to one another. And here we have one of the testimonies, the Father loves the Son. So that's the main force that keeps them together, that strong commitment, strong agape love to each other. This is the kind of love God has loved the world with. John 3:16, very familiar passage. For God so loved the world. Again, we have here the aorist tense or past tense in some sort of this word agapo or agapao, that he gave his only son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. This is the kind of love God has toward us, his children. So now we see God loves his son with agape love. God loves the world with agape love. Now we're talking about God loving us, his children. 1 John 4:10, we read, in this is love, agape, not that we have loved God. Again, we have perfect tense of the word of the verb agapao, but that he loved, again, the word agape, he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation of our sin. So number one thing that we need to know about God, this new commandment, that this is a command. God is commanding us, every human being, and especially he's talking about his disciples. If you're a disciple of Christ, if you are a Christian, this is direct command which God has given through his son to your heart. He's commanding you and me to love one another with this love, agape. The next thing we see here, Jesus saying that this is a new command. And this is a very important point here. Verse 34, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. The reason why he is saying new commandment, because there was old commandment. Actually, when Jesus was asked what is the greatest commandment in the law, he explained. He actually quoted two passages, one from Deuteronomy, another from the Leviticus. Let's read Matthew 22, verse 37. He is saying, and he said to them, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And second commandment is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. As I told you, that Jesus is quoting here old commandment, one from Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 and 5. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. As you remember, the book of Deuteronomy was written about 1,400 years before Jesus Christ. Actually, about one and a half millenniums. So it's quite old. So Jesus saying, now I give you a new commandment. And the second part of that commandment, Jesus commandment or old commandment was quoted from Leviticus 19:18. You shall not take vengeance or bear grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. So that was already known. God already explained it a long time ago that the love is the very important thing, and the first of all, we need to love God, and the second after that, we need to learn one another, to learn to love one another. That's the old and first of all, or the most important commandment. Actually, Jesus said a little bit after that, he said that the whole law is actually in this commandment. If you fulfill this commandment, you will be able to fulfill all the law. But the difference of new commandment compared to old commandment in a couple of things. First of all, Jesus is introducing here different kind of standard. Old commandment was saying, let's look again Matthew 22, verse 39. And second, like this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And there's a reason for that. I just told you that the highest known love for human beings is love for self. We are self-loving people. We are people, it's deep down into our hearts. So God is saying, exactly in the same way, you know how you love yourself. You know that this is the instinct. So now you have to match. You have to train yourself. You have to learn how to love others in the same way. You know how to love yourself. In the same way, just love others. As you want other people treating you, treat them in the same way. So that's kind of reciprocal thing. But now Jesus is introducing something entirely different. Now he's saying, now you need to love one another. Love one another, not as you love yourself, but as I loved you. We're dealing with something, with a kind of love which is greater than our love to ourselves. And actually, it's a different kind of love. It's completely different. It's unknown quality. We don't know that quality. We, as human beings, as sinful human beings, we are never able to produce that love. This is why Jesus is saying, love as I loved you. And later on, we'll read these verses in chapter 15 here in this gospel. He is explaining that the same love how Father loved me and I loved you, now you love one another. So that love comes from heaven, a different kind of love. It's not the same that all the movies and novels and songs, it's a completely different thing. Jesus is saying about heavenly love. And now when we become Christians, this heavenly love is available for us. Of course, that's our problem, that quite often we have that available to us through Jesus Christ, but we are not using it. We have not learned, we have not trained our soul to have that love of Christ. And as a result of that, we are doomed to chase that fleshly love, worldly love, exactly in the same manner how people live around us. This is the essence of Christianity. I will give you a couple of verses just to demonstrate that this is the biblical teaching. Philippians 2. Philippians 2, verses 4 and 5. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourself, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Actually, New American Standard Version, in my opinion, has better translation of this verse, verse 5. In New American Standard, we read, have this attitude. The word mind, it encompasses just thinking capacity, but attitude has thinking, mental capacity, and emotional capacity. In the Russian Bible, we read it "imeете чувствование," which means feelings, affections of Jesus Christ. But this word actually combines mind and affections. And I believe the word attitude is the best way to express. Have this attitude among yourself toward the others, which is yours in Christ Jesus. So we are commanded again here that we need to get something from Christ, which is ours already. It already belongs to us. And we need to have that process that we would accept it, receive it into our heart, and that this attitude would become our own attitude. Another passage, Ephesians 3. Ephesians 3, we read verses from verse 17 to 19. so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Look what he's talking about here. He's saying that Christ should dwell in us. He should make our heart a dwelling place. How it has happened? It happens through faith. So when we learn about Christ, when we get to know Christ, and when we trust Him, when we trust His goals for us, when we trust our desires, when we entrust our lives, our inner being is being changed because Christ comes through the Word. He doesn't come in any other way. He comes through the Word, and He comes with His truth, His thoughts, and His attitudes. This is why we read, look with me here, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, as a result, when Christ lives, then lives and dwells in us, well, then we see that we will be rooted and grounded in love. That's the first result which is known to others, known to us, when Christ lives in us. And then we see that we may have strength to comprehend. We have that godly wisdom now after that. And that leads us to verse 19, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses the knowledge. So that love of Christ is unknown to the people around us. But this is something which is available to us through Jesus Christ. So when we are talking about Christ's love, new commandment that we have to have in our hearts, Scripture tells us of several differences between Christ's love and worldly life that we know. Difference number one, the love of Christ is not focused on self, but on the well-being of your neighbor. So this is the key difference. If you want to check your own love, how you love, is that love which is coming from Christ, or this is something that we are mistakenly taking as the love of God or love of Christ? Christ's love is in no way self-focused. The neighbor's good is its joy and its focus. Of course, we know that, we heard about that, and we probably even try to do that, to generate, and most likely we quite often, quite soon find ourselves that we are not capable of producing that. And that's true. We ourselves, by our flesh, by our own natural ability, we are not capable of generating love which would be completely free from selfishness. But when we are reading about that godly love which comes to us through Jesus Christ, we see that that love is actually possible. Christ actually was the only human who came to earth and who was capable of loving without any kind of selfishness. You know, one of the key reasons why he was able to do that, because he entrusted the care of himself fully to his Father. We have that natural instinct, defensive instinct. We are capable of loving when we are feeling safe. We can even go farther in our ability to sacrificially love to others up to the point when we understand that something or someone is threatening us. In order to avoid that, the only way to avoid that, and when we are having that self-pity thought or any movement of emotions inside, that exactly at that moment it poisons real God's love. So what Jesus was doing, Jesus came to earth, and he completely, in absolute perfect form, he entrusted care from himself into his Father's hands. And because of that, he was free to move here on earth, and he was free to love, not being afraid of anyone who is threatening him. One example is very good passage in 1 Peter 2, verses 23 and 24. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. So Jesus' heart was free to love because he did not need to protect, to defend himself. Whenever we were trying to defend, to get defensive, defensiveness robs us out of love. You can find it in relationship between husband and wife. You can find it, if you will look carefully, you can find it. You can have a great relationship with people, with someone, up to the point until you start to be suspicious that he is taking advantage of you. She is threatening you. At that point, love is lost. It's poisoned. So if you want to learn to love by the love of Christ, you cannot avoid this point. You need to master your trust, trusting God, trusting Jesus. Now we see here a situation. Jesus was reviled, but he did not revile in return. He suffered. So he experienced pain, he was abandoned. He was left by his own disciples. So he was experiencing very tough time, but even at the point of deepest sorrow, Jesus was trusting God for it. Look again, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He mastered that. He knew what it looks like. And then we read in the next verse, he was free to love. To love to the utmost. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, meaning the cross. That's the love. That's agape love. That's real love. That's unstoppable love that we heard of. That love can conquer. That's real love. So this is the first point. We see that when we're talking about the quality of love of Christ, first of all, it's fully focused on the well-being of others. It does not focus on himself, on ourselves. Its direction completely 180 degree different. The second difference we see, the love of Christ is committed to the well-being of others in accordance with God's standard of good. And that's a very important thing. When we love others, it does not mean that we do everything what they want. No, when we love others with the love of Christ, then love of Christ is formatting our love. It's actually shaping it up. Love of Christ brings with it the idea what is good for that person. When I love somebody else with the love of Christ, I wish him the best. I am trying to do to help him to have that best. But the best is determined not by myself, and not by those people. It's determined by God. Sometimes we face issues when parents have difficulty with their parents, so grandparents are loving grandkids in a different way than parents love. And sometimes we as pastors have to deal with that. So in some situations, it comes to the problem between parents and grandparents. And the only way how to sort it out is that there is only one standard of love, standard of good. It's not determined by grandparents who now just want to give everything what grandchildren want. And it's not determined by parents because they are seeing it differently. No, it's determined by God. Grandparents and parents have one standard, God's standard that should rule them. This is what Jesus is talking here about. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we have an excellent definition of love. It's actually a wide and detailed definition of God's love. And let me point to some of the very interesting details in this description. In verse 6, we read, "It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth." So that's the foundation of that love. It's being driven by the truth. It's not willy-nilly wishful thinking that, oh, I just love. We quite often hear that kind of love. No, it's very, very clear, very strong, very determined love. And that love is shaped by the love of the truth. It rejoices, but rejoices with the truth. But look how in this description, two things combine together. Quite often, when we are talking about love in Christian circles, most often love is emphasized in more liberal circles. They would say, no hate. You probably remember those signs that they quite often demonstrate with. They would say love should rule, love everything, everybody, and because of that, we have those problems. By the way, quite often those people who have those signs, no hate, they are most violent people. Turned out the most violent demonstrations. But anyway, there is a notion that we should not be so picky about the truth. And we should just overlook everything, and we should just love one another, love everybody unconditionally, fully, and so forth. And there's another side. There are people who love the truth. And they will make it known that they love the truth. As soon as you are crossing the border at some point, you will know about that. All the wrath of God through them will fall on you. But here in this passage, we have this beautiful combination of two. Look how much it's said here of the kindness attitude toward the other people. Yes, it's being driven by truth. But it's all packaged with a lot of soft, a lot of kindness. Read with me. Love is patient. When you have to be patient with others. Of course, when other people are pampering you, they love you, they do they fulfill all every wish. You don't need to be patient with them. We have to be patient with somebody who makes us uncomfortable, who makes something difficult. Yes, we are committed to the truth, but we are patient to others. You know, in my pastoral ministry, and I'm in ministry more than about 3 decades already, I never seen one case when you explain someone his sin or her sin, and he looked at that, and he just fell on the ground, and he repented in ashes, and he turned around, and he is completely different. Even in the best cases, that person can truly repent, can really be sorry, but he will need time to get to learn how to live right. And during this time, what we will need? We need to be patient with him. This is why love is patient. And then love is kind or merciful in other versions. When we need to be merciful, we need to express mercy for those who are deserving something different. We need to be merciful. And this is the quality of love. When we're talking about God loving us, if you are walking with Christ for some time, look at 5 years ago. You look at yourself 5 years ago. And quite often, you see a lot of things which were not in the right order. They were wrong. But you know that God was patient with you? And 5 years from now, you will look back to today's day and you will look at yourself, who you are now, and you will say, wow, how God was able to just to bear with me. But he is patient. This is why Jesus is giving new commandment, and he is saying, love one another, not like Hollywood describes love. Love one another as I loved you. But quite often, we are more open to the preachers which are bringing us different kind of love than are willing to seek and reach out for this love of Christ. When you read further this chapter, at the very end, 1 Corinthians 13, at the very end, verse 13, and I will read two words from the next chapter. I believe it mistakenly got there. It should be in chapter 13. On our faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. Pursue love. So he's saying of something that is not ours yet. But we are able, it is possible. For us Christians, it is possible to pursue it and to get it. And point number three. We are talking about a command. Then we are talking about a new command. It's a command that God gives us through Jesus Christ. It's a new command. It's not the love how we knew it. It's not human-generated love. It's love which comes from God through Jesus Christ. And the point number three which we have here, it's a very important command. Very important command, and we see it in verse 35. By this all people will know that you are my disciples. If you have love for one another. As I just told you that sometimes liberal Christians, they're using this passage to justify their downplaying of doctrine. They would say, you see, Jesus himself, he is saying here, he is saying that you have to love one another and this is the number one thing. But when they say that, they actually pervert what is written here. They overlook, I don't know, maybe purposefully, they overlook the essence of this passage. When Jesus is saying that, he is saying that you have to have real Christian love, real life of Christ in you. And when that life is present, it will demonstrate itself by Christ's love. There are several passages in Scripture that allow us to make that conclusion. The number one, the love of Christ is always the result of faith. It cannot be produced by pep talk that I would just say, hey, you need to love, or you will be a bad Christian. You just cannot produce it. The only way to love is faith. There are several passages that talk about that. One passage we find in 2 Peter 1, verses 5 through 8. And again, I quote here NASB. I believe that NASB is more correct here. 2 Peter chapter 1, we read from verse 5. Now for this very reason also, applying all diligence in your faith, and I will stop here. There is a very important preposition, in your faith. There are some versions that omit that, but we see that preposition in the original text. In your faith, supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge, and in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, perseverance, and in your perseverance, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, and in your brotherly kindness, love. So he is explaining here way from faith to love. Faith is requirement. Growing in faith, this is the only way that can lead you to have real love. In another text, we read 1 Peter, that we have, the first one we had from 2 Peter. Now we have 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Look what he is saying here. He is saying that in order to get ability to love, we need first of all purify our soul, and this soul, this purification happens only by our obedience to the truth. So when we accept God's truth, truth about Jesus, truth about real love, truth about character of Jesus, about his attitude, about the salvation, about what God is doing through his gospel in our hearts. So when we purify, and when that happens, the purification targets number one problem, our selfishness. It takes away sin, and it frees us for the ability to love. There is no other way to love. If you are lacking love, real Jesus Christ love in your heart, the only problem, the main problem is the lack of trust in Christ. Lack of that process when we are getting to know Christ, knowing Christ, trusting him more and more, trusting in faith, and that should free us to love. The Apostle Paul adds in Galatians 5:6, we read, for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision or uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love. And we have many other passages that demonstrate the same thing. The real faith is driving us to the point where we are able to love. In this way, Jesus speaks of love as an indicator of the presence of real faith. Second qualification, we see that the love of Christ is the fruit of the Spirit. I already mentioned that we cannot produce it by ourselves. We should be sensitive to the Spirit's work in our heart. We should seek that. Galatians 5:22, we read, by the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. A lot of commentators who are studying this passage, they say that there is a big chance that the love is not just the first quality of the fruit of the Spirit, but is the quality of the fruit of the Spirit. And that the rest, 8 of those, are part of unpacking what love is. So he's saying that, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. And then joy, peace, patience, kindness, it's kind of outflowing out of love. But regardless of that, we see that love dominates here. We see that when the Spirit works in our heart, when he is working on our inner being. He is changing us. And first of all, he is bringing to us the ability to love with the love of Christ. This is why Jesus is saying, by these all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Number three, why this indicator shows us that that's the real Christian. Number three, the love of Christ is the source of joy. People around us all are searching for joy. If you look at your own heart, you are searching for joy. And God had provided a way for us how to get that. Of course, he is doing that in a very different way, not in the same way how people around us are doing that. He is providing that in the same discourse, in the same setting. We read Jesus is saying in John 15, verses 9 through 12, he's explaining how this joy is related to real love. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. He's saying about that connection. Love comes from the Father. Now Son loves us. Now he is saying, let this love abide in you, that you would be capable of loving others with the same love. And then he continues, just as I have kept my Father, verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Again, the relationship of truth and love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. That's a very important point. As I just told you, all of us are in search for joy. And if we don't have that process of being filled with the love of God through Jesus Christ, if we are not growing in that, then the real joy is not known to us. If that's the case, we are human beings, we live with constant desire to get some joy, and we will be seeking for joy, looking for joy somewhere else. This is why a lot of Christians, they are chasing joy in the same places where the world is chasing joy. And this is why there are a lot of disappointed Christians. Just because those sources of joy never satisfy. So Jesus is saying here that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. As I just told you, that real love, it focuses on the life or on the well-being of others and trusting Christ in that, and that produces that real joy. This joy comes from the experience when we become instruments of God's work with people. That understanding that you become a continuation of God's work. God is using you. He had found you worthy. He had expressed his mercy, not because of your value, but because of his grace. He had found that ability that he is using you for his great purpose. And that joy of belonging to God, the joy of cooperation with God, joy of being part of his great work, this is a joy that Christ had, and joy that makes our joy full. So true love is an indicator of a fulfilled life. Those people who have true love, they are satisfied people. They are joyful people. They have that real peace in their heart which is impressing people around us. They are in search for that joy, and then when they meet real Christians, they see the example that somebody has that real joy. And the number four, the last one, The love of Christ is the key condition for ministry. When we're talking about ministry, we're talking about the ability to serve one another. And we have one passage which explains us very well how it should work. Ephesians 4, verses 11 through 15, we read, "And he gave the apostles, the prophets, evangelists, shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes, rather speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ." So he is saying about the process here. The process in the church, we see apostles, we see evangelists, we see shepherds, teachers, and all of them are equipping saints. And that process of equipping saints, it comes to the point where people are growing in the knowledge of Son of God, growing to mature manhood, growing into fullness of Christ, and that prepares them for the ministry. And the first mention of the real step of ministry we find in verse 15, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head of who is the head, into Christ. So our ability to serve Jesus in his kingdom, in his church, is absolutely dependent on the ability of speaking the truth in love. In order to do that, we need to learn how to love. We'll pray now. And I would like to ask you one question. How do you obey this command? So this is commandment of God, repeated or expressed through Jesus Christ in a very special circumstances, emphasized command, this command which is very important, we see, and we cannot avoid it, we need to deal with it, and answer to yourself, before God, answer now. What are you doing with this command? And several things that I would like to emphasize, just to underline from this sermon that you would have better to remember it. Are you ready to commit yourself to true love? Today. You can just walk away from here and say, yeah, it's a good idea. It's a good idea to love. But if you will not make a commitment today, you will still be in the same place as you came here. We need to make a commitment. Number one, we need to commit that we would recognize the highest value of the love of Christ. We are lacking that understanding. We need to recognize it. Second, we need to commit today to pray that God would fill us with the love of Christ. He would teach us how to love. Pray about that in the same way as you pray when you are really sick or your relatives have life-threatening disease. You're praying fervently at those situations. Pray about love in the same way. Number three, learn to think about well-being of others while entrusting your life into God and forgetting about yourself. And with it, number four, in all your relationships, in all situations, make sure that your motives are free from self-love. So just check your attitudes. Whenever you have an attitude towards someone, check, is it being driven by real concern about his or her well-being, or you have something others. You have your own interest here. And number five, learn to fill your heart with the attitude of Christ toward others. You know, as I do it always, I love to pray kneeling down. And I would like to invite you, let's kneel down and let's talk to God about this ability to love, that He would teach us how we should love one another. Our Father, God, we come to You today together as a church. We come through Your Son, Jesus Christ. We come only because of His sacrifice on the cross, which made us Your children, made us part of Your family. And coming to You, first of all, Lord, we thank You for Your grace. Thank You for Your continuous mercy toward us. Thank You for loving us. Thank You for caring about us, providing with everything that we need, overlooking many, many mistakes and sins, and gently leading us out of our wrongs, helping us to come close to You, to understand You better, helping us to be more submissive to You. Thank You, Lord, for all of that. Thank You for the greatest example of love that You expressed through Jesus Christ. You gave something which is the dearest to You. And You gave it not because we were good, not because we were lovable, but just because Your heart is full of love, agape. And now, Lord, when we read this passage, when we read this commandment, new commandment, we find ourselves absolutely, completely incapable of loving. And we come to You asking Your help. Lord, please fill our hearts with Your love. Dwell in us. Change us, Lord. Fill us with Your attitude. I'm asking about myself and about everyone in this room. Lord, without You, we'll never be able to achieve it. And we ask all of that in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.